We're turning our attention back to those FA Cup semi-finals that you mentioned yesterday. It's going to be Chelsea against Arsenal, but of course Katie McCabe on show in the final in Wembley. We should mention as well that the first episode of the COYGIG pod from OTB SPORTS is coming this week in association with Cadbury FC. It's one we're really looking forward to. Your host for that is going to be Kathleen McNamee, and she is with us this morning. Good morning to you, Kathleen.
Morning, guys. How are you?
Good, thanks. Did these semi-finals, were they as one-sided as the scoreline suggests?
Yeah, they definitely were. I think Brighton in particular performed incredibly well in the first half to keep Arsenal at nil all for 45 minutes. But they just didn't have that extra step whenever Arsenal did decide to take things up a level. As for City and Chelsea, I think you look at Chelsea's record when they travel to City and it's never been great. And the fact that they were all over them, a couple of bad goalkeeping errors really, really let City down. But obviously that's an area that they're really have an issue with at the moment. They had a 16-year-old on the bench as their only other goalkeeping option, so it's not a great time for injuries in that part of the world. But they definitely were two very one-sided matches, and I think it'll be interesting to see when Chelsea and Arsenal come up against each other, because obviously Arsenal already have won one of those matches this season, and Emma Hayes will definitely be out for revenge.
Yeah, that's for sure. That City keeper ended up making a couple of remarkable saves late on in the game after a couple of howlers, which was, I don't know, some sign of a remnant of confidence in there as well. And you mentioned there then the clash between Arsenal and Chelsea, and Emma Hayes almost not calling out Arsenal, but saying before the game that she wanted Arsenal to be their opponent in the final. Is that just some sort of statement of we want this to be the best fixture possible for hopefully what will be a huge, maybe even record crowd at Wembley?
I think it's a mixture. I think Emma Hayes was very annoyed when they lost the first WSL fixture of the year to Arsenal. I mean, like, Arsenal and Chelsea has been such a great battle over the last few seasons in the league. And I think Jonas Edevall was saying after the Arsenal match yesterday that he was like, I'm almost disappointed that Emma Hayes is looking forward to facing us because I don't want that. I want her to be scared of us. Now, making Emma Hayes scared of a football team seems like a very tough task to do. So he may have his work cut out for him on that side. But I think it's a great week. I think the men are playing the same fixture, not the FA Cup, but like are playing each other that weekend. Arsenal are facing Barcelona later that week. So there's a lot of exciting matches around that time. And hopefully it does mean that you will have the two best, well, probably the two best teams in the country in the women's context facing off each other. It'll be interesting because when Chelsea and Arsenal did face in the league, Chelsea had come off a very short preseason. They had lost a lot of their players to the Olympics. I think that we're going to see a very different Chelsea side in this FA Cup match, and I think Arsenal won't be able to control it the way they did. It'll also be interesting because Arsenal have been playing like a much higher intensity game than they have been in previous seasons when it comes to things like injuries and just getting to that kind of Christmas period of the season where things are quite tight and there are a lot of matches, how their fitness and things like that will hold up because it has been an issue for them in previous seasons. So it definitely is a mouth-watering clash. And when you consider the teams that could be in it, I think it probably is the best setup for the best game.
Yeah, and you also kind of factor in the summer that a lot of these players had, and they've been playing quite some time, even Miedema getting a rest yesterday. Maybe kind of a show from Edevall that, like, we've got a squad here. We can kill you regardless of who's up front for us.
Yeah, exactly. Like, Miedema, Tobin Heath, Lotwoman Moy, they all got rested yesterday just because they had the Olympics and it was a difficult time. Like, they didn't really have any time between all the internationals and everything to give them a break before now. And I think you look at Arsenal's squad this year and it is, the depth there is amazing. Players like Beth Mead, who wasn't picked for the Olympics, has come out and, like, scored more goals than she has in any other season, is assisting at a crazy rate to everyone around her. Even players like Leah Williamson, she's already scored more goals this season than she has in previous ones. And then you have the likes of players like Katie McCabe, where Jonas Edevall said before at the start of the season that he wanted to improve how much Arsenal score off things like set pieces. And as you know, Ireland fans will know how great Katie McCabe's set piece taking is. And again, they've already scored more set pieces this season than they did in the entirety of last season. So I think what he has really done is he's taken that review that Arsenal did last season when things really were good. They were dipping, but they seem to have kind of caught them just on time. He's taken the foundations of Joe Montemurro put in place, and it has just elevated everyone in the team slightly. You look at the stats across the team and every single thing is just being improved slightly. And I also think his style of play is really interesting, that high press, especially in the final third, and the fact that he is making this team so comfortable playing out of possession, which has never been something Arsenal have been particularly comfortable doing. I think in some of the bigger games they've had, they've only had 40% of possession, but still come out and won at the other side. So it's going to be a really interesting battle against a Chelsea team that definitely isn't without its own firepower and style of play as well.
Katie McCabe as well. Like I say, there'll be a kind of a hype around that final here that wouldn't be normal at all for a Women's FA Cup final in Ireland, because she's just become such a big figure, and I think people just be very interested to see how she gets on that stage as well.
Definitely. I think the great thing about this season as well is that it's quite easy to actually watch Katie's Arsenal games and all the other Irish players as well that are in the WSL. So it means that when she's going up against a team like Chelsea or even a team like Brighton, it's easier to know all the other players and you're not just watching just because of Katie McCabe. But I think definitely, and especially with the hype that's around the national team at the moment, you know, those matches are going to come just after the international window. So depending on how they go, there's going to be more, hopefully they will come with some wins and there'll be even more hype around Katie and the other players, and there will be a massive interest, and hopefully it does translate into crowds. One of the interesting things of this season is with the new broadcast deal, it hasn't really translated to crowds. If anything, it's probably slightly affected crowds.
That's very interesting, yeah.
Yeah, because I think looking at the matches at the weekend, they were like quite poorly attended for what you would expect and even what we've seen in previous seasons, but they were both very easy to see on BBC and Sky. So it'll be interesting to see how that continues, and if it's the context of a big match in Wembley, will it be different? Because as well, Arsenal will be playing in the Emirates a couple of days later against Barcelona too. So those are two big stadiums to fill.
What sort of attendance are they expecting then for that FA Cup final? Because obviously the All-Ireland football final is always heralded as the biggest event in Europe. I presume it still has. So I'm just looking at it here. 45,000 is a record for an FA Cup final, which is still lower than a record for a women's All-Ireland football final here.
Yeah, that's the thing. We actually look at the attendances that you get for women's All-Irelands here, and they're incredible when you put it in the context of big sporting events across the continent. I would say they probably aren't going to try for a record crowd, just considering everything between COVID, the time of year, all those things. But I would hope that they would be able to get at least 20,000-30,000 out for that sort of event. I think it's one of those ones where it's going to take a lot of marketing. The Women's Football Weekend is in the second weekend of November, I think, as well. So events like that are always really good for pushing crowds out and kind of encouraging people to go. I think the context of the two teams, it being Wembley and also Arsenal and Chelsea, you know, that will be helpful as well in terms of fans who want to get there. It's not people having to travel from Manchester. So hopefully it can get a big crowd. But either way, I think what this season has shown is that there's much more of a production around women's football, and that has just made it a much more enjoyable product to like watch.
So in terms of the crowd then that'll be at that game, is there much of a harmony between like your average Chelsea and Arsenal fan who goes to watch the men's, or is it developing its own sort of separate identity within the club? Like, so like for match programs at the men's games, like, do they make a big deal of how the women's teams are getting on, or do they have kind of separate identities, or how does that work?
It depends on the club you go to. So Arsenal have always had this kind of very much like build a separate identity for the two teams while also integrating them slightly. So like you will have mentions of the women's games in the men's match day programs, and you'll also have a vice versa. You'll have, say, men's players wishing the team good luck on big match days. You might even get some of the players coming to matches depending on where they are. For something like Wembley, I imagine, because as well as an FA Cup final, there will always be a much bigger display and the club will put a much bigger effort behind it. And you could change it and look at a team like Manchester United, have been heavily criticised in the past for the fact that they never used their men's social media account to push big games that the women were on because they have such an incredibly massive following. Teams like City always tend to use the one social media account for everything. And then they also have a separate women's account, which they will post specific content on. So it really just depends between the clubs, like what they choose to do. I like the ones that kind of have a bit of a separate identity and also, you know, also push things on the main accounts. I think for this match, you will see a lot of like cross club support, which is good. In terms of the actual crowd, you tend to get a much younger crowd at women's games. They tend to be a lot more children and families, mostly because for a lot of people, the atmosphere is a lot more pleasant.
More affordable as well.
It's also, it's more affordable. It's a lot easier. Well, actually, it's a lot harder to get to in a lot of contexts if you're going out to Meadowview Park or one of these pitches that tend to be kind of off out of the city centre. But it is a lot more affordable. It has always pitched itself as like a family day out. And I know a lot of people in women's football are kind of eager for that to change, because you want to attract all sorts of crowds and not just say like women's football is just for kids. It's for everyone. But I think you look at a team like PSG and the sort of turnout that they get for their women's teams, where the ultras turn up no matter what it is, whatever team is playing. I think that's the sort of atmosphere that it would be great to promote around matches like these. You know, that even the hardcore fans, if you watch every single Arsenal men's match or Chelsea men's match, then why wouldn't you turn up and support the women at the same time? Everyone loves when their club wins. It doesn't matter if it's under eights or if it's the senior ones. You just want to get behind the team.
It's true. You mentioned there the Arsenal women have improved set pieces this season. Is it the same guru that's improved the men's team with set pieces, or what's going on with the parallel here?
I don't know. Maybe Kathleen McNamee is taking them in for lessons or what?
Possibly.
Yeah, it's interesting, the parallels that there has been. Well, it's not so much from the start of the season with the men's team, but more recently in the last couple of matches. I hope there is some guru going in and talking to the men's team about their set pieces, because it's been actually quite enjoyable to watch them the last couple of weeks, which it hasn't been in the past. And I know it's been said a million times before, but I suppose I think one of the main things for Arsenal and our improved form has been just having a bit more of a certain midfield, and shoring that up has definitely helped, and not having Arteta changing our positioning or changing what formation he wants to play every 5 days. It will also help in the long run.
Yeah, I think Nicholas Jover is getting all the credit for the men's team, the guy from City that they got. Are you seeing this Arsenal kind of surge at the moment as a possible top four contention, or is it way too soon to get that far ahead of ourselves?
It's far too soon for me. Having watched Arsenal for so many years, I know we go through these pockets of like quite decent form, and it does tend to be in the run-up to Christmas, and then we just kind of seem to peter off, especially in recent seasons. So I hope it is the sign of something different, and that this is at least a more stable time for us as a team, because I think it's been like, it hasn't been pleasant watching, and also for the team itself, there are too many talented players in there, like the Smith Rowes and the Sakas and stuff, that if we do want to hold on to them, we need to show some sort of consistency in the team. And again, my main worry would just be that sort of the depth in the team, in terms of if we do go through the sort of injury periods that we have in the past. Okay, we have one starting team that works, but what happens after that? What happens when one of those links gets injured and we have to throw on the players that we know can't perform? So I think it's hopefully the start of some sort of consistency, but there's also a lot of building still to be done, and especially in the bench depth.
The very, very, very bad news for Arsenal is that today is the 1st of November. It is going to be a disastrous month, no matter what happens, because it is Arsenal and it is November. Kathleen, very best of luck with the podcast, the COYGIG pod from OTB Sports, coming this week in association with Cadbury FC. Really looking forward to episode 1. Thanks a million for taking the call this morning.
Thanks, guys.